The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Steven Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Hello and welcome to the Big Scottish Football Podcast, episode 79. It is me, Steven Mill, alongside Ewen Cameron. How you doing, Ewen? You okay? Good weekend? Funny weekend in terms of the football, obviously. We'll get to that in a second. But how was your weekend in general?
The weekend started poorly.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the result in Dingwall, which we'll get to very soon.
Very funny.
It then got so much better because I ended up at the Hydro seeing Marty Pello, and it was an epic gig. It was a full house. It was a sellout. I was there with Kat Harvey, producer Kat. Amy McDonald was there as well, good friend of ours. She was there. Mm-hmm. And Marty Pello was kind enough to give us an executive box for the Hydro.
That's very good.
So
yes.
We had Limitless Pecora.
Lovely.
Limitless Haggis.
Bonbons.
The bonbons and the pepper sauce. Limitless, what do you call those things in the flaky pastry?
About
that size, with vegetables in them.
Like a samosa?
No, not a samosa.
It doesn't matter that much,
to be honest. What's it called? The crispy thing with vegetables in it.
A spring roll.
Limitless spring rolls with a dip. That was nice. There was a vegetarian thing, which was a truffle thing. Which I didn't really like. It felt like I was eating vomit. That wasn't very nice. And limitless champagne on ice. So it was a lovely evening.
But you weren't drinking.
I wasn't drinking because I was designated driver. So my wife was pissed. Amy McDonald was still in her bed at 1 o'clock on Sunday morning.
Right.
She was that drunk. And I think Kat is still recovering
from
the night. And producer Kat, I don't know how she made it at the breakfast show this morning.
So a good night was had by all.
Good night was had by all. Give me the wet, wet, wet bed thing that I've got. Give that wet, wet, wet bed thing because I just want to ask you two boys, name me three wet, wet, wet songs, Stephen.
Sweet Little Mystery.
That's what's playing in the background there. Well done. Give me another two.
Get By with a Little Help from My Friends.
That was a cover for Comic Relief.
And Love Is All Around.
Well done. Right, producer John, over to you. Can you name three wet, wet, wet songs?
Angel Eyes.
Very good. Yeah, that from Popton sold out.
Yeah. Stephen stole all the good ones.
No, he didn't actually. There's way more better ones than some of the songs he mentioned.
Step by Step.
That's one of their new singles. Look at what he's done. He's actually going on the computer system
I
to
know
look them
lots
up.
About Sweet Surrender.
Yeah, it's all very good.
Weightless.
Yeah, cheat.
If I never see you again.
Good night, girl.
Good night, girl's a great song.
Good night, girl's a good one, yeah. But that wasn't in Popton sold out.
No, it wasn't. It got to number one in 1992 and it stayed at the top of the charts for four weeks at the start of January.
Do any other wet, wet, wet songs out?
So what happened is that he came on, he did the entire Popton sold out album from start to finish. Then the curtain came down and we had a 20-minute interval and he came back and did the greatest hits of all the other songs.
Right, okay.
So it was very good. I'd met a lot of people who love the podcast.
Okay.
Loads of people I met. It was great meeting you. I don't remember all your names, but one particular person I did meet tweeted us in the picture that we took at the Hydro. Good morning to, and good afternoon, good evening to Liam, who is a Rangers fan.
Okay.
And he tweeted a picture of us together at the Hydro. Bumped into Ewen while up seeing Marty Pello the other night. Just want to say thank you to the Big Scottish Football Podcast who helped me through some tough times with my mental health in recent months. Keep up the great work with the pod. Thanks, guys. So, Liam, mate, it was lovely meeting you. I know you're a big fan. I know you've been going through some problems and issues. And I've been there myself, as you well know, Stephen. I've been there myself. And just keep talking, my friend. We're here for you. Drop me a DM. My DMs are always open. I went through 9 months of therapy with my mental health, and I'm feeling better for speaking out. So, Liam, keep talking, and we're always here for you, my man. That's all. So, it was lovely meeting you.
Yeah, all the best, Liam. Thanks very much. And, thank you to everyone who always has kind words to say about the podcast as well. We always appreciate
Liam
it.
Liam gave me a hug. He loved me.
Oh, that's nice.
I mean, I think he loved me more than his girlfriend who was there.
I'm not going to lie. I think the crossover between wet, wet, wet fans and this podcast, I didn't think there would be a big crossover.
Yeah, but
there we go. There we go.
Now, honestly, there was a good few people stopped me to talk about the podcast.
Excellent.
Which was lovely to see.
That is good to hear.
No movie reviews.
Excellent.
No movie reviews.
Great news. Aye, because after I mentioned it on the podcast last week, somebody has actually put up the point in last week's episode where you finish your movie reviews and you can go on and talk about other stuff. Because after I mentioned that last week, some kind soul did
has
it
done
last
that
week.
Again.
So lots of people were like, oh my God, you know, you're a saviour, whoever you are. But no movie reviews
no
this
movie
week.
No movie reviews because I was at Marty Pello.
Yes,
oh, exactly. See, before we go any further, I need to ask you something because this is well up your street. And producer John, you're listening, producer John?
Yep.
So this is what was trending this morning on Twitter, X. Royal announcement, Windsor, World War III, and Ric Flair.
Yeah.
Right, I don't know why Ric Flair's trending, and I'm not a wrestling
Please
fan.
Please don't tell me that Ric Flair has passed away.
No, I don't think he has.
No, he's actually, look at that on my screen right now. He is actually trending number five after Royal Family in World War III. So what's happened with Ric Flair?
I mean, he's probably coming out of retirement again or something.
He's probably been cancelled.
Yeah, or he's been cancelled, yeah, no
Ric Flair. It's just really weird to see that he was trending in amongst World War III and Kate Middleton and the Royal Family.
Maybe that's the big scandal that everyone's talking about. Maybe Ric Flair's involved. Maybe that's the rumours.
Woo! Woo! So yes!
That statement from the palace.
Woo!
So, Ric Flair, there he is. Hope he's all right. Anyway, last week's show, loads of feedback. Thank you, as ever. You can leave all your comments on our YouTube page. You can get that on Clyde One Super Scoreboard's YouTube page. We've got our own wee video section there, and you can leave your comments throughout the show as it progresses, and we'll read out the best ones next week on the show. Also, at Big Football Scott, obviously, as well. Parrot Esso, I should say. Ewen secretly feeding his dog to get it to 56 for Rangers winning the title is proper staunch. Well done, Jambo Bear.
My dog's at 52 kilos just now.
By the end of the season, you never know. Alexander Campbell says, Jesus, Stephen's explanation of Goldson's non-tackle. Come on, Stephen, watch the video. You sound like Michael Stewart. You also can't blame the ref for the Hibs players losing the plot.
Did you set up a dinner date with Michael Stewart, you and producer John?
Absolutely not.
Because you're talking as much shite as him.
No, I mean you gave also a terrible example last week of Zola Budd. So let's not be putting that on my desk, okay. I'm afraid. Davey G said, did Jambo Bear say that Michael Stewart is a FUD? If so, it's the most accurate football-related opinion he's had so far. Another person says, another conflict of interest in the Scottish Cup semi-final for Jambo Bear. It's okay, you can perform the happy dance behind closed doors when Rangers put Hearts out. Your not-so-secret is safe with me. So
I was really annoyed when Hearts drew Rangers.
So obviously Hearts squeaked past Morton last Monday night and then drew Rangers in the semi-final draw.
Nightmare.
So obviously,
it's
you
a
know,
nightmare.
Looking at the results this season, that will be an easy win for Rangers.
Well, at some point, we have to put in a performance.
Hearts sort of not putting in their best showing against Rangers, you know.
We've not been great. Right. I will be honest, but at some point, we have to be good.
Aye.
Look at Aberdeen. Aberdeen get accused of lying down to Celtic all the time. What happened there a couple of weeks ago? Aberdeen versus Celtic. What? Aberdeen put up a really good performance against Celtic.
Uh-huh.
Still got beat right now.
Yeah, they still got beat. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Nikki says, having my own sexy Pfeiffer moment today, woke up without a voice and it's giving Steven Mill episode 16, Meet Shirley Carter. What a combo. Lock up your sons.
What does that mean?
I think there was an episode way back when I'd lost my voice.
Right. Oh, Shirley Carter, who is...
In EastEnders,
EastEnders, and she is the sister of...
Heather? I don't know.
No, she's not related to... What's his name? Who runs the bar? All right, geezer.
Well, yeah, I think so. She's...
All right, I'm Danny. Shirley Carter. Danny Dyer. I'm Danny Dyer. Yeah, and I own the Vic.
Oh, possibly, yeah. He's Mick Carter, yeah. It must be sister.
Sister, yeah. And was she then...
I've not watched EastEnders for years.
But who's... Heather is... Was that not a sister as well?
Heather Ferguson. I don't know.
But she died.
I don't know.
And then, were they not best pals?
EastEnders fascinates me because I'll dip in every so often and I'll be like, don't know that person, don't know that person. Oh, there's Ian Beale. Don't know that person, don't know that. Oh, there's Phil Mitchell. Don't know that person, don't know that person. That. But I was listening to something a couple of weeks ago. Apparently EastEnders is like on its knees. Like it's only getting like a million viewers. But it used to be like 8, 9, 10 million.
But that's why they're bringing back a lot of the old faces from back in the day. Like, see, what's the name of the actress that plays Janine? I went on a night out with her in Glasgow when I was working at STV. She's a phenomenal night out.
Mm-hmm.
She's so down to earth.
I mean, Janine has
laugh.
Died in EastEnders before.
She's back.
Yeah, but she's back.
She's back. What's her name again? What's the actress's name?
Charlie something. Charlie.
We follow each other on Twitter. What's her name?
Charlie.
Charlie something.
Charlie something.
Charlie Brooks.
Charlie Brooks. She's brilliant. Yeah. Love her to bits.
Yeah, anyway. So EastEnders is knackered. On Ewan's movie reviews, actually, Pablo Robbo says, Ewan makes me laugh out loud, but he really is ignorant about films.
How dare you?
He's mixed up Rebel Moon with The Creator here, and I would never trust his judgment with what is worth watching.
He's actually right, because Zack Snyder directed Rebel Moon, which is a Netflix movie.
Was it not The Creator, or is that something different?
The Creator is... There's two movies, so they're both movies. Right. Rebel Moon was Zack Snyder. He always wanted to make a Star Wars movie, but Disney wouldn't let me anywhere near a Star Wars movie. And then what does he go and do? He goes and makes his own sci-fi movie, which is a rip-off of A New Hope, which was the first in the trilogy for the Star Wars series. So he's went and done basically a rip-off of that in his own style, and it's a load of pish. I think I watched like 20 minutes of it.
Yeah, just Andy Taker also saying the Zack Ryder film was Rebel Moon. Yes. Also, Temple of Doom is a prequel to Raiders and features Short Round, so gets bonus points for that. So
Temple of Doom was a prequel to Raiders of the Lost Ark?
I didn't know that. Carrera says, I like the movie recommendations. Keep it up, Ewan. Nobody cares about the rugby, though. Pure pish.
No,
thank
they do.
God that's finished.
Well, and it was a poor... Again, Scotland, so unlucky.
Don't care. Brendan Booth, I'm a lover of Ewan's movie reviews and would listen if we ever decided to branch out and create a standalone movie-themed podcast.
What do you think, Stephen?
The Big Scottish Movie Podcast.
What do you think?
Ugh, I couldn't be arsed.
We could get in, like, different actors and people who love movies into the studio, and we could talk about their favourite films and dissect them.
If you want.
Would you dare?
Do I need to be there?
Aye.
Why do I need to
be there? We get a third person to sit in the middle of us.
Somebody else to do it. I've got other things on. The review of the week comes from Key McLeod. Please can we start a GoFundMe and get Ewan replaced by AI? Remember, you can leave your comments anytime on YouTube, as I mentioned, and our Twitter page, at BigFootballScott. You can comment on our Super Scoreboard channel on YouTube, as I mentioned, and also on Facebook and Instagram as well. You can get us there. Let's get to the football, shall we? Lots to get through. Let's start with probably what was the game of the day on Saturday, which was Kilmarnock versus St Mirren. It was fourth versus fifth going into it. They swapped places by the end of it. St Mirren were cruising at half time, 2-0 up, brilliant performance in the first half, but then Kilmarnock blitzed them. 18 minutes, 5 goals. Derek McInnes described it as a real man's performance afterwards, and it's hard to argue Kilmarnock were just unbelievable. It could have been more than 5 in the end. It was incredible.
Stephen Robinson said they were lucky to get away with 5.
Mm-hmm.
They were that good, Kilmarnock, in that second half. I mean, I thought St Mirren were superb in the first half. 2 good goals as well, 2 set pieces that caught Kilmarnock sleeping. But Kelly, for me, the strength and power they've got. See, what's his name? Matty Smith. Is it Matty Smith?
Matty Kennedy.
Who's Matty Smith?
Matt Smith is an actor that Doctor Who. Used to be Doctor Who and so was in the crowd.
It wasn't the Doctor Who guy down the left.
No, it was Matty Kennedy.
Matty Kennedy. So Matty Kennedy down the left. You've got the boy Armstrong down the right. You've got the likes of Vassell. You've got Watkins. You've got Van Veen. I mean, they have got...
Your favourite Watkins,
They're powerful. They're
great
strong.
Great header from Watkins, actually.
Oh, I was about to say the third one.
Yeah.
Oh, the header. I mean, he creates a power for that.
Did you see Derek McInnes' celebration when he ran down the touchline and picked up the ball boy and all the rest of it? That was quite nice. But I think definitely the goal was young David Watson.
Oh, from halfway line.
Like from inside his own half. I mean, fair enough, the defending is absolutely honking.
They're gone, by the way. Are they? I mean, you can literally see a team gone.
Just totally done. But fair play to him. Like, weaves his way through and then a great finish in the corner. So, like, he looks like a real prospect as well. So,
I think that result for Kilmarnock is a nail in the coffin of St Mirren when it comes to finishing fourth. I think Kilmarnock,
I mean, there's only 2 points in it,
but I just think that's such a massive result for Kilmarnock to come back the way they did. I think they're nailed on for fourth now. I think that's a damaging result for St Mirren.
To be fair to Derek McInnes, he did say before the game that he's actually taken quite a lot of inspiration from St Mirren last season.
Aye. And I can see that.
They were like, if we can replicate their points total, then, you know, we'll not be far off European football. We'll definitely be in the top 6 sort of thing. So, Kilmarnock absolutely smashing St Mirren in the end on Saturday. A couple of VAR things to speak about. We'll get to that in just a wee second. Though elsewhere, it was finally a win for Aberdeen, who don't have a manager, ending their 11-game winless streak in the league. And they managed to get past Motherwell by a 2-0. Again, we'll get to the VAR stuff in just a wee second. And you know, really disappointing from Motherwell's point of view. But I said on the big Saturday football show, I fancied Aberdeen on Saturday. There was no rhyme or reason for it. Obviously, they'd lost to Dundee during the week as well. I just thought, see when teams are on these long winless streaks.
That's dead at some point.
They have to win at some point. Like, they have to win at some point. I just fancied them on Saturday. And the same goes with other bet. If teams keep winning, I'm always thinking to myself, well, if I'm having a bet or something, I'm like, well, I'm going nowhere near them because they have to lose eventually. And it's always when you least expect it. So,
but again, Motherwell were unlucky not to get something from the game.
Yeah, of course. We'll get to the VAR stuff in just a wee second.
But a much needed win for Aberdeen.
And of course, one of the names that has been linked with the Aberdeen job, Christian Titz. Of course, of
that's the, genuine, by the way,
the
we're
German second
up.
Division. So, might be a couple of big developments over the next wee while with Christian Titz. And if that happens, obviously, we'll let you know about it. Ewen is officially on Titz watch from between now and the end of the podcast. So, Christian,
see the newspaper guys, they are praying,
absolutely
praying. I mean, the headlines write themselves. There he is, there. I'm just having a look at him. That's Mr. Titz there.
Do you think he could win a cup?
That's Titz. Right, okay, yeah. Jinky could win a cup, do you think? He could win the cup, so he could go...
Do you know who Mr. Titz looks like?
Who does Mr. Titz looks like?
He looks like Glenn Michael.
I don't know who Glenn Michael is. It's before my time.
Glenn Michael Cavalcade?
No idea.
The cartoon TV show for kids.
I've heard of it, but it's way before my time.
But I think Titz looks like Glenn Michael.
Right, okay.
Do you want me to show you a picture of Glenn Michael?
Yeah, you could show me a
Most
picture.
Most people listening would I'd know rather who Glenn, that. Glenn Michael's a Scottish legend.
I know, but like I'm too young for it and don't remember it. So well, it's before my
time. I'm with you, Ewen.
Yeah, well,
because
you're old as well.
That's Mr. Titz.
He does look a wee bit like, yeah, Glenn Michael. Glenn Michael's Titz. So... Glenn Michael Titz.
What was the name of his lamp producer, John?
Paladin.
Well done! Point to you, my man.
He's what?
He had a talking lamp.
A talking lamp.
Well, it didn't
talk,
did it? Just flashed.
No, it talked.
Did it talk?
But it flashed as it talked. You did missed it? Out on a whole bit of childhood here, Stephen. He used to bring on the cartoons on a Sunday, didn't he?
Did Paladin talk?
He did, aye. He had like a...
I remember it flashing.
I
think somebody was just under the desk and just pressing the off and on button.
George Bowie's good pals are going, Michael.
I'm not... Did Paladin talk?
He did, aye.
So to tell you a wee bit about Christian Titz, former Hamburg manager, he's currently managing in Bundesliga 2 for FC Magdeburg. Again, they've got this German guy involved who sort of not set up Hoffenheim, but was one of the sort of people who built it into what Hoffenheim is today to do this football report. So that's obviously where this link has come from. Ewen, we said on the podcast last week they're likely to go for a foreign coach.
Yes.
Would you go for Titz or would you go for something else? You're a Titz man, basically. You putting your weight behind Titz? Like, what are you doing here?
Well, I don't know much about Titz.
Right, okay.
Personally.
Right. Well, I've just told you. I've just
appeared from nowhere.
I've just explained about Titz for you.
Yeah, and if you are going to Google Titz, make sure you spell it properly because you've
got
some,
Z at the end.
You don't want to be Googling Titz.
No.
The wrong way.
No.
Because you'll get something...
Christian, if you just Googled Christian Titz with an S, you'd just get sort of like... nun porn or something like that. I presume.
So listen, they've clearly done their homework on Titz.
Yeah.
Right? They've done their homework because nobody was aware of him or who he was, but now Aberdeen are being linked with him. So that would suggest that they have made some sort of contact with Titz.
Yeah. They've inquired about Titz.
They've inquired about Titz.
I'm just reading here about Titz. And he's published several specialised books on football training methods. So he's obviously a deep thinker as Titz.
Yeah.
And he obviously, Titz thinks a lot about football.
Is he a family man? Has he got wee tits?
I'm just outside football.
Is he a family man?
I don't know.
Any wee tits running around?
I don't know if...
You have a few to work with when you get to Aberdeen.
Yeah, exactly. So... we'll keep an eye on the Titz situation for you. And
I'm actually going to Google Christian Titz without the Z, see what happens.
Right,
don't
okay.
do that.
I think you know what's going to happen.
Yes,
here.
And you're right.
Yeah. And don't pretend you've not Googled that before.
Yeah, is there any truth in the rumour that they're thinking about going for the East Fife manager as well, Aberdeen?
So it's between Tits and Dick?
I haven't heard that one, mate. No.
You never know.
Listen, I mean, do you know what?
Wait, so if it was a straight choice between tits and Dick, what would you go for, Ewen?
Well, I mean, we'll see when it comes to Dick.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Unbeaten as East Fife manager.
And do you know what? You can't really go wrong with Dick, could you?
No, you could. Absolutely. He's solid. He's hard to beat.
Really hard to beat. Because he sets his teams up really well.
I'd actually like to see Dick and Tits go up against each other. I think that would be fantastic.
What if he gets something as his number two?
So
Christian Tits is the manager and Dick is the
Tits and
number
Dick.
Tits and Dick.
Tits and Dick.
What? 2024.
He's very. So, anyway.
Oh my God, the fun we're going to have on the podcast for next season.
I mean, Alan Burrows, Dave Cormack, if you're listening,
please
appoint Christian Tits.
Please.
It would be the best thing ever.
Everybody in Scottish media wants this to happen.
And it's also, like, I can't wait for, like, the news, like, report in Scotland and, like, Raman on STV News and stuff like that. They're like, Christian Tits. Like, it's going to be amazing.
And see when Aberdeen are, like, beating Rangers or Celtic and it's a really big result for them and Christian Tits is sat in the dugout and the fans go, get your tits out for the lads. As is to step out
to
of
step the...
To
step out, exactly.
Step out and give them a wave.
Exactly.
Tits, geez a wave. Tits, geez a wave.
I mean, chance that basically, you know, you can no longer sing and are no longer really sung, I don't think.
Yeah.
In this day and age, and quite rightly so. But obviously, if Tits does make a comeback...
Aye.
Should
we stop now?
Yeah, exactly. Right.
But that is a genuine manager that Aberdeen are looking at.
Christian Tits. Yeah. He's definitely in the running. And we'll see what happens there. Anyway, let's move on to Hibs beating Livingston.
Before you do move on, Aberdeen have said that they expect to have their new manager in place before the next league game.
Yes, obviously international break coming up, so it gives them a wee bit. Hibs beating Livingston by 3-0. Pretty professional performance by Hibs. Livy, they were affected by a sickness bug in the preparation for this game, but they lost 3-20 and they're now 10 points adrift at the bottom. Ewen Cameron, I hate to say it, I think you might be right. Livingston are done. You've been saying it for 3 or 4 seasons now, and finally,
get my wish.
Broken clock is right twice a day and all that. So, I think Livingston are finished now. That's them done.
Hibs worry me. And the reason they worry me is because they're actually a good side and their new signings are slowly but surely bedding in at Easter Road.
I think they look excellent going forward. The boy, Mylida.
Oh, Mylida.
Very, very good. I like Lafondra as well.
I like that McCondis as well. I mention him every week.
But midfield. I still think defensively.
So I think what they'll do, obviously, they've got a good bit of back in there. What they're going to do, they've got midfield to up front sorted if they can keep that team together. I think they'll look at sorting that defence in the summer, and if they do, they're going to be a threat next year. So I'm a wee bit worried about what they may become, because as it stands right now, they're looking the part.
They are in the top six as it stands as well after that win on Saturday. Obviously, Dundee not playing this weekend. Celtic beating St Johnston by 3-1, so that means Celtic are back to the top of the table. Obviously, Rangers not playing yesterday as well.
It was 3-8.
Yeah, it could have been a lot more. They had lots of goals ruled out for offside, I think, correctly. Not really many arguments there. We'll talk about the handball and stuff and VAR WTF in just a wee bit. St Johnston, mega struggling, just a point behind Ross County, because Ross County beat Hearts by 2-1. Ewen Cameron. What's happening there?
What?
How are Hearts losing to Ross County? So, obviously, Clyde won Superscoreboard is on Saturday afternoons. Many people listening will have been listening to that. In the rest of the country, we do the big Saturday football show. Myself, Ewen, and former Hibs and Aberdeen striker Steve Cowan. This is what Ewen had to say before the match on Saturday.
these sorts of games are preparing us for that semi-final. I don't see Ross County causing Hearts many problems today. I think Hearts will win comfortably.
And just a reminder, it's Ross County 2, Hearts 1. Mm-hmm. So is there a sad dance to be had today? Or what?
I mean, you're being a smart arse.
Of course there will be a sad dance.
Oh, shut up.
Why is there... Why, well, you had a happy dance last week.
Yeah.
So.
Shut up. You're...
What?
Listen. There was a few... The referee wasn't great. Right? No, but it's true. I'm being honest.
Hearts weren't great.
The referee wasn't great.
Hearts weren't great.
I think...
Ross County deserved to win.
No, I think you're wrong there.
Hearts...
I think you're wrong.
Really, really poor defensively. Poor goals to lose.
A couple of defensive mistakes, yes. But I think if we'd come away with a draw, that would have been a fair result. I don't think the referee was particularly good.
I've got two questions for you. Right.
No, I don't answer. I don't need to answer your questions.
Two questions.
We're 11 points clear in third. That's what matters at the end of the day. Is it nice
still
to lose?
Still got Kilmarnock to play twice.
Doesn't matter. We'll still be 5 clear even if they beat us. Listen, we're 11 clear. The objective at the start of the season was to get third in European football. Mm-hmm. That's going to happen. The other objective was to get a decent run in the Cups. And we had a good run in the League Cup and we got knocked out by Rangers in the semi-final and we're in the Scottish Cup semi-final.
You knocked out in the semi-final with Rangers again.
No, we won't. Yeah, yeah. We actually will not get knocked out. I actually think we will turn up because I think we'll learn from our mistakes, but we'll get to that nearer the time. This was a blip. It's a blip. I'm not angry. I'm not upset.
So, no, but I've got two questions because I got quite a few tweets at the weekend and I imagine you did as well.
I ignored them as well.
First of all... Stephen A. Smith, is he safe this week?
He's fine.
He's fine?
His objective was to get a third.
You're
European
fully
football.
Behind Stephen A. Smith.
100%.
100%. Okay, that's fine. And secondly, many tweets asking me to ask you this on their behalf. Would you say Hearts are in a title race as of now after losing to Ross County on Saturday?
Uh-huh. I did see some of those tweets, eh?
Yeah.
I think they're funny. Hey, these punters think they're funny, eh?
It's quite funny.
It's not funny.
It's quite funny.
Because
you said literally what?
Three weeks ago you said
that Hearts were in a title race.
If we beat Rangers and Celtic.
Aye.
And we only beat Celtic.
Yeah. So you no title race?
No, we're out of that now.
We're out of that now. Right, okay, good. Uh-huh. Right, excellent. That's all I want.
I can officially confirm the Hearts are not in a title race.
Okie dokie.
So stop asking your stupid questions because there's the answer.
Dundee versus Rangers off yesterday. A bit of a shambles.
But is it?
The pitch, a disgrace. I feel sorry for the fans, again, who have probably travelled from all over. Why didn't they call it off at, like, they knew this at 8 o'clock in the morning, 9 o'clock in the morning. Why didn't they just call it off then?
The reason I say, is it a shambles? And I'm asking that question because it's worse than that. It's embarrassing. It's embarrassing for Scottish football. It's embarrassing for Dundee. Dundee Football Club are a Premiership football club. That is their fourth game that's been postponed because of the weather. Fourth. 200 yards down the road is Tannadice. How many games have they had postponed?
I have no idea. I presume none.
Yeah. They've got a problem with that pitch. But I think they know that. And then they had, what was his name that came out the other night, day there, yesterday, the chairman
Nelms,
boy.
John Nelms.
He said, I think the line was that it was the weather forecasters had predicted 2 millimetres of rain, but they had 12.
Right.
But you knew it was going to rain. What precautions did you put in place? You knew it was going to be raining on Saturday night into Sunday morning. What did you do to combat that when you know your pitch is pish?
It's a cow patch.
It's an embarrassment. And do you know, ultimately, I actually think that Dundee have actually helped Rangers. Now, I know Clement and Rangers were upset at the game being postponed, but that was public facing. I think behind the scenes and in the dressing room, they're giving it that, dancer. Yes. Because I thought they looked quite leggy against Benfica on Thursday night and they've got a few decent players that are out injured. With that game being postponed on that cow patch, I think it helps Rangers. It gives them 2 weeks to prepare for Hibs and then they've got Celtic after that. And then by the time they play Dundee, they might have their best players back.
But they also might have to play Dundee in that period as well.
Well, it would be funny if they actually scheduled the Dundee game before the Celtic game on the Sunday.
Well, that's the thing now. So I mean,
but was, you know what I'm getting at?
Yeah, I totally. There was chat yesterday. They could have pushed back the kickoff. Obviously, there was no Premier League matches really yesterday. No, I know there was only one. So like in terms, I think Sky, from what I'm reading, were open to that. And for whatever reason,
the SPFL said no.
The SPFL or Dundee or Rangers or whoever it was weren't up for that.
It was SPFL that said no.
So,
but what I think was, what I think again was missed by people like Chris Sutton and the likes, is that they were coming on Twitter and they were having a pop at the referee for not making a decision earlier. Well, the reason the decision wasn't made earlier because they gave it every opportunity for that pitch to be playable. And what they decided...
But that's no good for fans. Yeah, that's no good for fans.
We know that, right? We understand that. But Don Robertson made it clear on Sky Sports. He said the words. He spoke to both clubs in the SPFL. He spoke to Dundee, he spoke to Rangers, and he spoke to the SPFL. And they all agreed amongst themselves that they'll give it till 10:15 to see if they can get the game on. So that was an hour and 45 minutes before kickoff. Is it a shame on the fans? 100%. Is there consideration being given to the fans? Not really, because they've called it at such a late time. But I think they've given it to 10:15 because I think the ground staff have said, we might have this pitch ready.
The ground staff were apparently working on the pitch at 5 a.m.
Yeah.
So they knew it was a problem.
But then your chairman says, well, if they'd put the kickoff to one, we'd had the pitch ready. But you don't know that. I think there was a lot of BS going on yesterday at Dens, and they were passing the buck here, they were passing the buck there, they were blaming the weatherman, they were blaming Sean Batty, they were blaming Judith Ralston. Oh, they told me it was 2 millimetres, but it was 12 millimetres. What a load of BS. Your pitch is pish. And there has to come a point where Dundee are going to have to be punished.
So...
because that's embarrassing, not just for Dundee, but for Scottish football as a whole.
So, just to clarify here, you think Dundee should be, what, fined?
Oh, aye. I mean, that's the fourth game they've had postponed because it's a cow pat.
What happens in a season that there's like a big freeze and there's four or five postponements at home? Do people still get fined if that's the case? Or
no, but Stephen, you're playing devil's advocate
here, right?
And you're right to do so, but Dundee have got a track record of this. Look what happened to the Aberdeen fans. 45 minutes before kickoff,
completely.
The Aberdeen fans who have made that journey from Aberdeen to Dundee get told 45 minutes from kickoff, yep, the game's off because my pitch is shit.
Dundee will not be fined. And I'll tell you why they won't be fined.
Should they?
Because the clubs make their own rules.
But should they?
And they know that it might come back to bite one of their clubs. Dunfermline have had 3-4 postponements this season as
but
well.
But should they?
I mean, well, yes, but they won't. Dundee will not be fined.
Because the clubs have got their best interests at heart.
Because if it's Dundee this season, it might be Motherwell next season. Or, you know, that's just picked off the top of my head. Or maybe Aberdeen the next season. There is no... because, again... if rules are rules, if you have 3 or 4 postponements, say you have 3 postponements and you get a warning, 4 you get a fine, what happens next season if there's a massive freeze? You know, do you just chuck that rule out? It's nobody's fault. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So Dundee are not going to get fined. But does this not make the case for plastic pitches to be in the top flight of Scottish football? Because yes or no, answer this question. Had that been a plastic pitch yesterday, would the game have been on?
Yeah, of course it would have been on.
Well,
if it was concrete, it would have been on. The problem is that Dundee have a grass pitch.
These terrible grass pitches.
But they have an issue there, which is why they want to move.
Which you don't get with plastic pitches.
Are they not trying to actually move from Dens to a new location?
Yeah, they're building a new stadium.
Because they know there's issues. The stadium's not up to scratch. Aye. The grass is poor. The drainage is poor. It's just a poor, poor pitch. And they've had issues with it all season.
So they should put a plastic one down and then they wouldn't have any problems. Because then that game yesterday would have been on. See, I actually just wanted to mention, because there's going to be the vote on the plastic pitches, right? And I'm winding you up, obviously.
Well, Livingston are gone.
Yeah, so there's going to be the vote and Kilmarnock are apparently
getting
grass as well. So it looks like it's going to go through. And everyone's cheering and celebrating and all the rest of it. Fine, right? Obviously, a really good grass pitch is better than a plastic pitch. We both agree that. But it's just the way that it dominates discussion. It dominates everything about plastic pitches. Like everyone going on about how we should get rid of plastic pitches, they're rubbish, they're this, they're that, as if that's the issue in Scottish football.
Well, no, I think there's bigger issues.
There are bigger issues. There are far bigger issues, but so much time is spent bleating on about plastic pitches all the time. And I just think if only people could focus their attention on the actual issues.
See, for me, the plastic pitch, and the reason it's a big talking point, it's a debate, and it has been a debate on this show as well, is because as a paying customer who pays their hard-earned cash to go and watch a game of football, the last place you want to go and watch football is at Livingston.
What about Kilmarnock? 7 goals on Saturday.
No, but again, you look at Kilmarnock over the season and you watch the games, it's hoofball.
Ewen, can I just cut in here?
It's hoofball. It's hoofball's back to front. There's very little football played on these pitches because you can't play football
on
these pitches.
That is nonsense.
Just because you play on plastic and Falkirk and you're playing against Dindy teams.
Question, who are the highest scorers in the SPFL this season?
It'll be Falkirk.
It will be Falkirk. You're right, because we play a good brand of football
and you play against pitch teams.
Mostly plastic pitches.
You play against
pitch
teams.
But we play a very good brand of football.
You're a full-time team playing against part-timers.
We played a full-time
You're playing against plumbers and joiners and dentists.
Absolute nonsense. Absolute nonsense.
And farmers.
So, I mean, I understand why it's such a heated debate, but I just think a lot more attention should be spent on other things in Scottish football. And hopefully, once this vote is carried and it's through,
That's it.
And
it'll
we can
never
put to
be
bed,
discussed again.
It will never be discussed again, especially not in this podcast. So, Rangers obviously will have to replay that game. As it stands, they're a point behind Celtic at the top of the table, but obviously have that game in hand as well. Right, let's drop down into the Championship and talk about the title that nobody wants to win, because Dunfermline beat Dundee United on Friday night. A cracking performance at East End Park. And it just goes to show that when all our players aren't injured, we're actually a not bad team. So 3-1 win against Dundee United, but then on Saturday Raith Rovers had the chance to take advantage. They didn't though. 0-0 draw against Queen's Park at Hampden, and that means that they do draw level with Dundee United, but they'll be looking at that as 2 points drop, definitely.
100%. First of all, congratulations to Dunfermline. I did say to you last week, in the game you played against Raith Rovers, you deserve to get something out of the game. I thought you were the better team against Raith Rovers, and what you've done is you've followed up that good performance by putting an equally good performance against Dundee United, and you deserve to win that on Friday night. I was really impressed with Dunfermline, especially the boy at number 7 who's been injured most of the season,
Kane Richie Hosler. So he signed from, he was on loan from Rangers B last season and then signed from Rangers B in the summer.
So he's your player?
Yes.
Well, he was very, very good, and he scored a really good goal as well. So fair play to Dunfermline, really good result. Poor, poor performance from Dundee United, but they got away with it because Raith Rovers, as you say, haven't taken advantage. 0-0 against Queen's Park. And do those two at the top not play each other soon?
Yes, they do. A week on Saturday. So Dundee United are at home to Inverness. Raith Rovers don't have a game this weekend because I think they're due to play Airdrie, who are playing in the Challenge Cup final on Sunday. Oh, so right. Dundee United play Inverness on Saturday, and then the following week, Tannadice, probably the game of the day,
yes,
anywhere in Scotland. It's Dundee United versus Raith Rovers. What I would say about Raith Rovers, though, is they did get a point on Saturday. That's their third clean sheet in a row. Obviously, they beat Partick Thistle during the week, beat Dunfermline the week before. So,
Who did Dundee United play this weekend?
Inverness. Who?
Where's that?
Inverness at Tannadice. Inverness, who lost at home to Ayr United.
Okay, so let's assume then that Dundee United win that. They go 3 points clear. They know if they beat Raith, they go 6 clear, even though Raith would have a game in hand.
And
but that would be huge.
And also, the goal difference is huge. So yes, Dundee United have a plus 23 goal difference,
right, so that's
advantage,
more or less a point.
So it's a point.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Raith Rovers know that even if they beat Dundee United at Tannadice, assuming they beat Inverness,
yes,
on Saturday, the Raith Rovers can't go top of the league.
Yeah.
So big game for Dundee United on Saturday. I mean, Steve Cowan, former Hibs and Aberdeen striker who we do the show with on a Saturday, he describes Jim Goodwin as an unlucky manager. I mean, I don't know if he's an unlucky manager or he's just not a very good manager, but Dundee United are making a hash of this. They are limping towards the finish line.
They are, but they'll get there.
You know, I think you and I both agree that we think that they'll get there. It's a huge game at Tannadice in a couple of weeks, though. If Raith Rovers win that, that puts them in pole position for winning the league. Dundee United look like they're crumbling. The goals that they lost,
it was poor on Friday night
was so bad.
But again, I thought Dunfermline played the game really well. I thought they played some decent football. And you got a wee bit of pace in your team with the boy that we've just talked about. Yeah, Dundee United were poor, but I still look at that team and I think there's quality there. And I think with people like Tony Watt and the boy midfield who I really like, can't remember who it is, and Declan Gallagher at the back. I mean, they've got the spine of that team's really good. Also like Middleton, he's got a bit of pace. And he made a difference when he came on in the second half. Why he didn't start Middleton at the start of that game? Because he went with a back three. Why did he go with a back three? I think it was because he saw something in what Dunfermline had done against Raith Rovers. They tried to counter that. It didn't work because Dunfermline deserved their victory. So he tinkered with the team. He tinkered with his formation. And it came back to bite him in the ass. He ain't going to do that against Inverness, and he won't do it against Raith Rovers. He's got to go with what he's been doing all season. They've scored a lot of goals, and I still think that Dundee United have got enough in them to win the league, despite making it really difficult for themselves.
So we mentioned Livingston being pretty much done in terms of relegation. It looks like they'll be playing Championship football next season. Arbroath at the bottom of the table. They look like they're going to be playing League One football. They are 8 points behind Inverness. They do have a game in hand, but they were thumped on Saturday by Airdrie, 5-2. Airdrie up in at the playoffs now as well, leapfrogging Morton, who lost at Partick Thistle by 2-1. Partick Thistle, their first win in nine matches or something like that. So it looks like they're pretty solid in the playoffs. But then you've got one place up for grabs, I would say, in the playoffs now. Airdrie, Morton, Dunfermline, Ayr United. There's 4 points between those teams. Dunfermline have played a game more. Who's getting that fourth place?
It's a flip of a coin, isn't it? Although the coin
a four-sided coin.
I need a four-sided coin for
a cube.
That.
Well, no, because a cube's got more sides than that, actually. So I'm trying to think what it would be. A four-sided thing. Can you get a four-sided thing? I don't think you can. Can you get a four-sided shape?
No, you can't, no.
No, I don't think
there
you
must,
can.
There must be a way to get a four-sided...
No. Because a cube, you need six sides for
I know what a cube is, mate.
Right, well, you try it. Right, you draw something down there, you, and it's a four-sided shape, and we'll see if we can make it.
Hold on, let me see if I can draw this.
If we can invent
a four-sided
shape. I was just going to say, this would be the crowning glory for this podcast if we managed to invent a new shape.
But maybe there is already a four-sided shape. Go and Google that, John.
It's a square. It's called a square or a rectangle.
No, but that's not four.
That's not four-sided.
A 3D.
I would need to...
You could do is a pyramid. Like, you can get a pyramid dice.
That's a point.
But that would be five.
No, a three-sided pyramid.
A three-sided pyramid?
Always, it's never going to sit on a point.
You can get dice that are, you can get a four-sided dice, you could do that.
No, you can't.
You can get a four-sided dice. I used to play Dungeons & Dragons, I know this.
But it's always going to land on the same thing.
No, it's not, because it's shaped like a pyramid.
Oh, no, you're right, yeah.
You got a picture?
It's called a tetrahedron.
But look where it's going to land.
It'll land flat. Because it'll be the same. It's called a tetrahedron.
So it could land on either one of the sides or on
it's got four faces and six edges. So actually, we're not inventing anything. It's already been invented.
Yes,
so,
I remember.
It's got six edges.
So what we need is to decide which one of Airdrie, Morton, Dunfermline and Ayr United, we need a tetrahedron.
Roll the tetrahedron, everyone.
Roll the tetrahedron, and we'll see what happens. Queen's Park down to eighth. Inverness are struggling big time. They have not won in something like 9 or 10 matches, and they are mega, mega struggling. So, or only one win, I should say, in that time. Right, League One. It was Edinburgh City relegated officially, the first team, the earliest ever someone's been relegated in the SPFL era, certainly. So Edinburgh will be playing League Two football. They lost again on Saturday against Alloa by 5-2. Alloa up to third place because Montrose dropped some points at home against Annan. Kelty Hearts, 5 defeats in a row for them. They got beat by Cove Rangers, who play Hamilton this weekend, who beat Stirling Albion by 3-0. So it's not quite over yet. and Falkirk beating Queen of the South by 4-1, coming back from a goal down to win that one. And Falkirk can win the league this weekend. They'd be the first team to do so, obviously. And it would take Falkirk beating Edinburgh City at home, which you'd expect they would do. And Hamilton need to win against Cove to keep it alive. And
where's that game?
It's at Cove. Oh. So I think Falkirk, I think you'll be celebrating on Saturday night, John. I think you'll be celebrating.
Unfortunately, I'm missing the game on Saturday.
Amazing.
Where are you?
I'm in Copenhagen for a stag. I mean, when has a team ever won the league in March? When I booked this up,
Dunfermline have done it twice. Right. So okay. both times we won league.
Was that league one?
It was in March, I think.
I can't recommend Copenhagen enough. I was there last summer when I went to see Coldplay. So I went. I did a wee. What's that part of the world called?
Scandinavia.
So I went from Copenhagen to Oslo. Copenhagen to. What's the place in Sweden?
Stockholm.
Yeah, I went. No, the other place?
Gothenburg.
Yeah, I went from Copenhagen to Gothenburg to Oslo. Right. And I did that in a week. So I started in Copenhagen. And my biggest regret was not spending more time in Copenhagen.
Well, it's good to know. Could you recommend a karaoke bar in Copenhagen where I can sing We Are the Champions?
I mean, when you go abroad, you don't go to a karaoke bar.
I've been to a karaoke bar in a number of places.
Abroad?
Yeah, I went to a karaoke bar in Riga, in Latvia once. It was
That reminds me of a story. I turned up at a karaoke bar in Iceland, Reykjavik. Mm-hmm. Scotland beat Iceland by 2-1.
Yeah, I remember.
Gary Naismith scored, Bertie Vogts was in charge. And I walked up the stairs in this bar. There was myself and Alan Ruff when I used to work on the Real Radio Football. So, that would have been some point in the naughty. So what year?
This is the Real Football Phone-In with Ewen Cameron and Alan Ruff. Call now on 0845 100 2101.
What year would that have been when Bertie Vogts guided us to a 2-1 win over Iceland in Reykjavik? Because I was there. And at that night when we'd won, all the media were out in the city centre of Reykjavik and we'd all gone and got something to eat and some had splintered off and gone off to do their own wee thing. And I went with Ruffy and... was it Derek Johnson? There's a few of us anyway. We went into this bar and then up the stairs in the bar was a karaoke bit.
It was 2-0 and it was 2002.
Oh, was it that far back, was it? Went up the stairs to...
We also beat them 2-1 in 2008.
There's that one. Naismith scored. Gary Naismith scored.
That was under George Burley. No, it was Kirk Broadfoot and James McFadden.
So was it 2002 Naismith scored?
It was 2002 and it was Gary Naismith and Christian Daly that scored. Right.
So 2002, so myself, Ruffy, and I think it might have been Derek Johnson, who was working on Superscoreboard at the time, and I was at Real Radio, and we went up the stairs in this bar where there was a karaoke bit, and as we came up the stairs, turned to our right, who was stood on the karaoke? Rob McLean of the BBC.
Rob McLean, and what was he singing?
I can't remember what he was singing, but we just...
I think Rob McLean... Rob looks like a Mustang Sally kind of guy. I think a classic Mustang Sally. Uh-huh. I think that's what
because
it is.
Because he was there with...
the BBC or Satanta?
No, it was Satanta. It was Satanta because he was there with Colin Davidson, who was in charge at Satanta, and he was sat there watching Rob singing.
Mustang Sally.
I can't remember what the song
was.
But I remember being Mustang quite Sally. Impressed by Rob singing, actually. Oh, okay. That was, 22 years ago? Jeez.
Okay, so Falkirk are going to win the league. Edinburgh relegated, and it's all on for the playoffs. Let's move on to League Two and hand over to our correspondent in the White House. It's President Joe Biden.
Hey, Ewan and Stephen, what's going to happen first? Steny winning the league or Kate Middleton being spotted in public? Do the Warriors want to win this league? They drew with Forfa, meaning those Falkirk bastards can win the league before the mighty Steny. Still 15 points clear of Peterhead, though, as they could only draw with Dick's men. And remember, we all love Dick on the Big Scottish Football Podcast. Yeah, what a huge day at the bottom end of the table, though, as Jobim calls Clyde Edge ever close to Stranraer and Bonnyrigg with that great win away to the Rose. There was also a huge victory for Elgin down at Stair Park, pushing them 8 points clear of the basement spot. And what about those Suns? Dumbarton bounced back from two defeats to smash six past Spartans in Edinburgh. What a laugh. Anyway, better go and do some president stuff. See, I wouldn't want to be you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Enjoy your president bye-bye. Stuff. President Joe Biden there.
I just need to correct Joe Biden. He's clearly not up on the latest news involving Kate Middleton because she was at a farm yesterday.
So they say.
There's no pictures of it.
Exactly.
But apparently locals did see her and she was smiling and looked in good health.
Okay.
She was out with William. She'd just been to see the kids playing.
Do you know
sports.
When papers say onlookers?
Onlookers.
They make that up.
You're not adding to it. You're a conspiracy theorist.
Did
guy.
You just say she was out with Will Young?
She was out with Will Young.
Did I say Will Young?
Yeah.
I never said Will Young.
She always preferred.
I said Prince William, did I not?
She preferred him over Gareth Gates.
Did you say Will Young?
Did I say Will Young?
I think it had to be William, but it came out like you sounded like she was out with Will Young.
She was out with Will Young. She's evergreen. And.
Gonna take this moment.
I think she better leave right now.
Gonna last forever.
So, VAR WTF, let's move on to
la
this.
La gente está muy loca. What the fuck?
Right, a few on the weekend to get our teeth into. Let's start with Celtic, Ewen Anderson. And it was a handball check on Robinson on the line for St Johnstone, who blocked it. Now, it clearly hit his arm. I would say it would be incredibly harsh to give it as a penalty because the ball was booted at him from about a yard away. I don't think his hand was in an unnatural position.
But it did stop a goal.
But given what we're about to go on and talk about in the Motherwell game, it's a clear handball. It hits his arm.
I think it's inconclusive. And the reason I think it's inconclusive... Even when slowed down, did it hit the sleeve line?
Now, I did see people saying that.
So I'm not sure.
There's also the Alistair Johnson one from earlier on in the season against Kilmarnock.
When he fell over.
Now, again, Alistair Johnson did not mean that, but no. He stops a goal.
But did not hit the sleeve line as well.
But again, was it inconclusive?
Okay, so if I said to you...
You just said it was inconclusive.
If I said it was 50-50, you can't give it, can you?
I no.
Are you more likely, or should you give
no,
it?
No, I mean,
if you're not sure, do you give it?
I think, as we've spoken about 5 million times on this podcast about the handball rule, I think see if it even hits him a wee bit lower down, right? And it's not on his sleeve. Say it's conclusive that it hits below his sleeve.
Hits his bicep.
I still don't think it's a penalty because what's he meant to do? He wasn't deliberately doing it. Mm-hmm. He was about 2 yards away, and the ball was booted at him.
Yeah. Now that
now if you make the rule any handball penalty it's given, then fine, fair enough. You can't argue with that. But there's so much grey area when it comes to the handball rule.
It's interpretation.
Now, again, that wasn't given on Saturday, but we could go forward a few weeks and we'll see them given.
Yeah.
For similar things, I think, right? Also, let's move straight on to it. The Motherwell one, the Lennon Miller goal that was ruled out. A handball for
bring
Theo
Bear. Down a bit, still, man, nothing.
Yeah, it's a wee bit loud. So Theo Bear, it was given against him. What's he meant to do? It brushes his arm.
Right, as far as
there was also, and I know Sports Scene mentioned this over the weekend as well. Motherwell conceded a goal when it hit a Ross County player's hand.
In the lead up to the goal. Yeah. Okay.
So this is what annoys people.
Right.
There's no consistency.
Well, I'm here to sort it.
Right.
Because I'm the IFAB expert.
Yeah, you're invited up to Loch Lomond the other week.
Yeah, I was actually there at the time. No, they're in Glen Eagles. A lot of the main guys were staying in Glen Eagles.
Oh, were they? I saw you were.
So anyway, I'm the IFAB guy. I have read the IFAB booklet from start to finish.
Yeah.
So I'm very aware of the rules and regulations when it comes to the handball situation. If it strikes your hand, right, mm-hmm. and it ultimately leads to goal, i.e. so if it hits Theo Bear's arm and he scores,
right,
ruled out.
Okay.
Even if it's accidental, it's ruled out.
Mm-hmm.
Completely ruled out. That should not be a goal because it struck his arm and then he's put it in. Remember what happened with Dessers?
Yeah.
Who was that against?
Can't even mind.
So remember, he come into him and it does hit his arm, but then it bobbles around. I think
somebody else hit it in.
No. There was a scramble. Somebody else had a shot. Tom Lawrence had a shot. The goalkeeper saves it. Then it rebounds back to Dessers. So it's another part of the play.
Right.
And then Desso scores.
Right.
So he didn't directly score from the handball.
Right. Theo Bear didn't.
That's my point. That should never have been given that goal should never have been ruled out in a million years, because it's not him that scores the goal. It's not him that scores the goal. The referee's messed that up.
He wasn't even, like, he just jumped and it brushed his arm.
The referee messed it up. Now, if it brushed his arm and then he volleys it in, he's used his arm to score the goal. That's what it would, that would be the interpretation. I kind of understand that.
So
when Dessers does that outside the box in the 6-yard box at Ibrox, can't remember who it was, he does that, he kind of catches his arm, but it bounces away from him, and then Tom Lawrence has a shot, it rebounds around the box, and then Desser scores in the third phase of play. That's fine. But that's what happened yesterday with that's what happened on Saturday with Motherwell. It was another phase of play. It should have been given. That goal should have stood. Aberdeen got away with one there. The referee messed up. As far as I'm concerned, he's messed up.
So previously in the season, when Ross County did score a goal against Motherwell, and then the build-up, a handball was used.
But there was two bits of phase before.
No,
that.
I know it wasn't the person who scored the goal that handled it, but there was a handball in the build-up to it. That should have stood as well.
That's got to stand up, because the referee hasn't given the handball. He hasn't seen it to give it. But he himself directly hasn't scored the goal from the handball.
Again, this is why people get so frustrated. Kettlewell was going off his rocker.
That's why I'm here, because I'm the IFAB expert.
There was also maybe a wee
shinny.
Shinny. What's going on there?
Well, Willie Collins looking right at it. And shinny kind of does that with his hand. Kind of like as if he's got a broken wing.
So again,
you know, like a chicken whose wing's sprained.
You compare that to the Celtic one, or the St Johnstone one, I should say.
This is more of a penalty.
Of course it is.
The shinny one's more of a penalty.
So what's going on here?
See, the thing is, though, right? So VAR would have looked at that, but they can see that Willie Collum has a direct view of it. He can see it. He's looking right at it. So it's not a clear and obvious error. Willie Collum is clearly deemed that not a penalty.
But I mean, it is.
I know. It is a penalty.
It's a clear and obvious
because
error.
Because
he's not given a penalty.
He kind of lifts. Because see, if he doesn't do that, in front of him are two Motherwell players who are ready there for the ball.
Yeah.
And because it deflects off his arm, it doesn't get to the players, which would have been a goal scoring opportunity.
So I'm afraid you've had a shocker at Motherwell versus Aberdeen.
Yes, you have.
On Saturday.
Poor.
Get
me into the VAR room, because I know IFAB better than them.
And on another day, Celtic would have had a penalty. I mean, it wouldn't have mattered at the end of the
day
anyway.
I know it's the analogy that everybody uses, but can you imagine that situation where Celtic's and Johnson happened with Hearts and Hibs?
Yeah.
Or a Rangers or a Celtic, and it meant something.
Precisely,
but it
yeah.
means something.
Yeah.
That ultimately didn't mean anything at the end of the day. Could come down to goal difference.
I suppose,
this
yeah.
This is that as well, but you've got to get it right.
Let's speak about Hearts. A couple of things.
Oh.
So the Stephen Kingsley free kick, it was given offside for Shankly because he was obstructing the view of Wickens. I don't really see the complaint with this one. What's he doing there anyway? I mean, he could have been stood at the halfway line and Kingsley's shot still would have rattled in. So I don't understand what they were doing there. Stupid.
He moves too slow and too late out of the goalkeeper's eye line. And I agree with you. Shankly doesn't even need to be there. Because
yeah.
that goal's going in. The keeper's not getting there.
Yeah.
It's such a cracking free kick. So I think, and I hate to say it as a Hearts fan, I think the referee and VAR have got that right. Shanklin is blocking the view
of course he is, yeah.
off the goalkeeper.
It's offside. However, the penalty, or not penalty, as it was.
This is a shocker.
So, Lauren Shanklin gets booked for diving.
Diving? He got booked for diving?
I think Hearts have appealed it. I don't even know if... Can you do that? Well, they've tried anyway. I thought there was contact there.
There was. It was the boy's thigh on his knee. So, Shanklin turns him, goes to strike the shot, and the boy lifts his leg up, and as Shanklin is turned him, his knee strikes the thigh of the Ross County defender and it trips him up. The referee thinks he's taken a dive. There's clear contact. It's a clear penalty. And again, VAR, who I'm praising for getting the Kingsley goal right, non-goal right, or whatever you want to say, they've messed up there, because see when the referee runs over and he gives Shanklin a yellow card for a dive, VAR are looking at that can go, well, that's a clear and obvious error.
Mm-hmm.
That's not a yellow card.
Yep.
Go and have a look at that because there's contact there. So VAR themselves have failed to intervene when they should have done their job and went, you need to have a look at that, rescind that yellow card and give a penalty.
No, I agree with that as well. I thought he was a bit unlucky there. Right, Kilmarnock, St Mirren. Both of St Mirren's goals, they spotted this on Sports Scene as well. So Marcus Fraser blocking Joe Wright for Dunn's goal, and it happened again.
His second goal.
For Mandron as well.
Didn't affect play,
it's
though.
Well, it did, because it stopped them getting...
It didn't directly impact.
I think
it's clever play.
Well, that's the thing. Where's the line between clever play? Because you know,
standing your ground. He wasn't holding on to him. He kind of just stood his ground.
It's blocking.
Yeah, but he never held on to him. He wasn't holding his shirt.
Aye, but you can still block somebody and not hold on to them.
Yeah, but I'm not going to get out your way. You get rid of me.
I know, but I'm saying they've done that deliberately to obviously give them an advantage.
Mm-hmm.
It's whether, like, if you did that anywhere else in the pitch and you just stood there and blocked somebody, regardless, you would get the free kick against
possibly
you.
For obstruction.
Yeah, exactly. So, again, it's the inconsistency. Now, I personally think it's fine.
I agree.
I think it's clever play.
Yes.
From Stephen Robinson and his set piece team and all the rest there. I think it's that's
okay,
fine.
Two examples for you. Wait, two examples for you.
But then again,
two examples for you.
Yep.
The one that happened in the League Cup final, Liverpool.
Yep.
I think that's actually the right decision to give a free kick.
I completely disagree.
And disallow the goal.
I completely disagree.
Endo's standing in an offside position and he stops the Chelsea defender from getting back who was marking Van Dijk. I think they made the right call there.
I don't think they did.
And then you've got the similar one with
Manchester City.
Manchester City, it was Alexis McAllister and I can't remember who it was and allowed John Stones to come in because he was blocked off. That was the right decision because...
I don't think it was the right decision either. Like, how can you say they're the right decisions, but the decisions on Saturday weren't?
I think they're two completely different incidents and they're not
comparable
in
any
way. He's standing his ground.
I think
he's not intentionally putting his arms out or running up and grabbing onto them.
Yet another example of where some games they'll give them, some games they won't. They can't make up their mind. It depends who the referee is. It depends who the VAR is. Fair enough. You've just given two examples that are in the Premier League down south. It's different referee and different associations.
But everyone has a different interpretation. Like, Stephen, say, for example, I like Marty Pello.
Right.
But you might not like him as much as I do because that's my view. And my interpretation and my opinion when it comes to Marty Pello is that it brings me joy, it brings me fun, it's nostalgia, it reminds me of former girlfriends and moments like that. For you, you have a different interpretation, a different opinion of Marty Pello. And that's the same with the referee. Not every referee is the same. Everyone will see things differently. They interpret things differently. You keep going on about consistency, and I understand why you go on about consistency, but not every human being is exactly the same. My opinion on a block is a different opinion to you, and it's the same for a referee. They see it differently. You can't expect them all to be robots. Do you want AI to be in charge of football?
Yeah.
Do you want computers to be in charge of football?
Yeah. I'd give that a good laugh.
But that's my point. You're never going to get consistency.
No, I accept that. Right, okay. That was VAR WTF. Let's move on and do a final version of this, shall we?
Oh, yes. Oh, I'm not
the Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewen Cameron.
Do you know what? This might be one of the best reactions we've ever had to this.
I know. This was great. We got so many comments on this. So it was Start Sub Sell. And this is our final version of this as well. So thank you
to everybody.
To everybody who's taken part in this over the last few months. You need to decide out the three options, which one you start, which one you sub, which one you sell. You know it by now. So last week, it was Stephen Mill, Ewen Cameron, and Jose Quitongo. Lots and lots of people getting in touch. Craig S, 7896, says, Start Sub Sell. I went to high school with Stephen, and he was a really good friend of mine growing up. Five asides, hitting the town, etc. A really great guy, and always a brilliant laugh. So for that reason, he makes the bench. You and your panned, and Jose, he starts. So thank you very much.
Do you know him?
I do know. Yes, he's a lovely guy. Nicola Doyle says, start Jose. We'll get a good game from him. Sub Ewen, he tries so hard in the quiz and sells Stephen as he started Jambo Bear. Poor Ewen.
Thank you, Nicola.
Alan says, start Jose, sub Stephen because of his knowledge of the game, which would help out in the park, and sell Ewen so you wouldn't need to watch him eat Monster Munch in the shower after the game. Key McLeod says, start Jose because he's brilliant. Everyone loves him. Sub Stephen, always professional, doesn't complain. Not sure about that. Obviously selling Ewen Cameron. Moans all the time. Childish, ruins movies for everyone. Too much of an ego. Takes too long to answer questions, so he holds the team back. Christ, how long have you got? David says, start Jose for the obvious reasons. Sub Stephen definitely seems like one of those gives you something different kind of options off the bench. And sell Ewen because I can't hear him say etc, 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 etc 40 times a day. You do that all the time.
Etc, etc.
Start Jose because he's Jose. This is from Aaron Wheeler. Sub Stephen because he mostly knows what's going on. Sell Ewen for his awful takes on Indiana Jones, and everyone knows The Last Crusade is the best. John says, start Stephen, the true leader of the podcast, has the ability to wind up the opposition and is dependent.
Oh, no, yeah.
Sub Ewen, handy squad player to chip in with a solid contribution, but needs to do more, i.e. answer DMs. Sell Jose, lack of knowledge on the modern game is no use.
That's very true about Jose. Yeah, he doesn't know much about the game today.
Dave Trump says, start sub sell, start Ewen, complete and utter tube, top with a squished, deflated balloon face. And his complete idiocy and incompetence makes him a surefire starter, simply for the banter. He says, then says something else, and we'll move on. Sub Jose, complete legend and the happiest man in the world, coolest cat in town. Sell Stuart.
Who's Stuart?
I don't know who Stuart is. My dad's called Stuart. So,
possibly.
He's a solid performer, but will get a good fee. I would rather see him go into brighter pastures and not be on a weekly podcast with Mr. Knockoff Potato Head with two first names. That's very harsh. Rory says, start Jose, wee man's a baller. Sub Ewen, lacks individual brilliance, but gives 100% every time and has a 3-day stamina, apparently. Sell Stephen, he's not a team player, it's all about himself, and his Jim White impressions are busting my chops.
Oh, that's harsh.
I've not done Jim White for weeks now.
But I do like your Jim White.
Paul says, start Jose, he's a ray of sunshine. Sub Stephen Mill, because the traffic news won't read itself on Super Scoreboard. And finally, sell Ewen, the movie reviews and the eternity it takes him for answer questions in the quiz are quite frankly getting on my Christian tits. Rangers Class says, start Ewen, he was the real radio football phone-in.
He knows it.
He has a 50-kilo dog, and his film reviews provide entertainment to many. Sub Stephen, a good wingman for Ewen. However, his team don't play top-flight football. He cheats on the quiz, and he's the producer's pet. Right. First of all, it's not my fault I'm filming and playing top-flight football. I don't cheat on the quiz.
And producer John is. He loves you.
He's a Falkirk fan.
Yeah, I know, but...
Listen, I get that. John looks up to me because, obviously, they're down in League One, been skittering about right, there for
right,
years.
Right, right, okay, you're my favourite.
He aspires to be...
Where you are.
One of my friends. Aye, that's what it is.
Yeah.
And Sir Jose, unfortunately, there was loads more that came in as well. So thank you to everyone who took the time for that. I'll just say Big Guy J as well. Stark Quitongo, still in excellent shape and top shagger. Sub Stephen, opinionated rule follower, would carry out instructions to the letter. And Sell Cameron, disruptive and divisive in the dressing room, and you'd get minions for him. I don't know if he means millions, I'm not entirely sure. But anyway, you've had your say, and this is the final start sub sell.
And who ultimately made the decision about, and all the votes that were cast, who made the decision on this final three?
Well, they were all,
producer John?
They were all counted up, yeah.
Producer John counted them all up because there was loads.
Nothing to do with me.
There were all loads on YouTube, loads on Twitter.
Now, what I would say, I think this backfired against you, right? So last week, I didn't start me. I started Jose.
No, I started me.
Yeah, no, exactly. That's what I'm saying. I think that backfired on you.
No, it didn't, because I know I'm the best. So whatever this result is, it's irrelevant and it does immaterial to me.
So it's immaterial. It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter to me.
So start Ewen was the final result.
Start Ewen?
Yeah.
So I am the best. Then why start me?
It's immaterial, though. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, this vote. So
so what is the final result?
Start Ewen, sub Stephen, sell Jose.
Is it really?
No, it's not really. It's start Jose, sub Stephen, and sell Ewen. So there you are.
Sell me. They want you to sell me.
Get a lot of money for you.
Sell me.
Yes.
Sell me. Right. Screw yous. I'm going to Radio 1 or 5 Live, Sky Sports, and then let's see what happens to this pishy wee podcast when I leave yous. I am the man.
I think you said it was irrelevant what happened in this poll.
Can't believe they want to sell me.
I didn't say that, but I did actually.
10 years on the football phone, and I was a huge success, won awards after awards after. Is the real football. And you need to stop doing that as well, you prick. Alan Ruff, call now on 0845-102-101. And you need to stop that as well, because I get people do that to me. When I was doing the breakfast show the other week there. Doing the greatest hits breakfast show with Kat, and somebody at the end of the call went, "Cheers, mate, mate, mate."
You say mate or mate?
Yeah, but don't speak like that.
Mate. You do a wee bit.
Mate, stop. Mate, see that? I get that a lot, mate, right? Mate. And the Jambo Bear thing. See when I was at Marty Pello there?
I have told
people people shouting across the hydro, "Jambo Bear! Jambo Bear! Hey, Jambo Bear!"
I have told people many, many occasions not to call you Jambo Bear.
Can we move on to Jose?
Mate. I should mention, we'll get to Jose in just a wee second. Scottish football in the bin. It's coming back next week. Okay.
Oh, brilliant.
It's coming back next week. So get your suggestions in on @BigFootballScott. If there's anything over the last 6 months or so that has been getting on your Christian tits, then get in touch. Scottish football in the bin. We will put it in the bin for you.
That's a good name for a feature if Christian Tits gets a job.
What?
Getting on your Christian tits.
Getting on your Christian tits. Yes, exactly. So @BigFootballScott on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, all those stuff as well. And remember, you can leave your comments on the YouTube page as well. A reminder, Clyde on Super Scoreboard on every night this week. And it's International Week, so that'll be busy. 61025. And also you can get them 01419511025. Gordon Duncan taking your calls along with the guys all the way through. And you're on Saturday, John? Are you on Saturday?
We are indeed covering the championship.
Covering the championship on Saturday.
I'm suggesting we should be covering League One because there might be the first champions in Scotland.
There might be.
Yes. Why do you care? You're in Copenhagen.
You're in Copenhagen. And then obviously on Saturday we are on across the rest of the network.
Can I take a day off? I can't be arsed talking about the Diddy
TFM, MFR, NORTHSOUND One on the big Saturday football show with former Hibs and Aberdeen striker Steve Cowan. Right, okay, let's call Jose. It's late. We're really late for Jose today.
I don't think he's answering.
Our favourite Angolan footballer who's played in Scotland, called Jose.
It's 14 clubs in Scotland or something.
Yeah, something like that.
He's not going to answer. It's too late.
It's too late. He'll be eating his
way
lunch.
Too late. Nah. He's in the gym or something.
Aye.
Or he's looking into his mirror telling himself how much he loves himself.
Hello.
Jose! Yay! Jose! How you doing, mate?
Hello, thank you.
Where are you?
In the jail.
You're in the jail?
Yeah.
Oh no, what's happened?
Oh, I fight with my neighbours.
You fight? So there's some sort of neighbourly war going on. What happened?
Okay then, I'm home.
Okay,
Jose, I've got some breaking news for you, my man.
Hey, tell me.
See, when it comes to start, sub, sell.
Oh my God.
Wait, I've got some breaking news, bud. A nation has decided that you're the best thing about the podcast.
So you're starting, mate.
Okay.
You need to pull your boots back on. You're starting.
Okay, no problem.
Excellent. Good stuff. Excellent.
Did you have a nice weekend, Jose?
Yeah, very good. Quiet, but nice. Very nice. Can't complain.
Can't complain. That's nice.
I'll use...
Yeah, good. We're all good. Quiet. Yeah.
I went to see Marty Pello at the Hydro.
Okay. He's still good?
He's still good. I feel it in my fingers.
Na 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 na.
Because love is all around me.
Good. No, he's good. I like Mark Phil.
Yeah,
good.
It's very good. It's very good. Can you name me another wet song?
I just like that one. Na 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 my finger. Yeah, that one.
That one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's his favourite. Yeah, that's his favourite. What you got on this week? Anything exciting, Jose? Anything happening?
No, listen, I don't know. Explain. I'm now boring, but life now, especially just gym, training, home, you know what I mean? But I love it. I can't complain.
Excellent. Good lad. That's what we like to hear. Right, Jose, we will let you get on with the rest of your day. And thanks very much. We'll speak to you next week, okay?
Bravo, boys. Thanks a million. Thank you so much. Thank
love you. Bye, bud.
Jose. Jose is all around us. Right, okay, Scottish football's even greater, hardest question. What is the connection between Maurice Malpass and Fernando Torres. The answer is in this envelope here. It is signed, it is sealed. And let me go through some of the suggestions that have come in this week. Ronnie says they both played football. You did say not to think about it too much. Ronnie, it's a little bit more complicated than that. John says their surnames both have six letters.
They do.
Shut It Fat Boy says Morris had a wee bird who just liked Torres during his Dundee United days. Don't know what that means. Sounded better in your head. Kevin says Malpass's wife is called Maria and so is Torres's sister.
Oh, that's good. I like that.
Darren says Torres was born in the same year that Morris Malpass had his first cap for Scotland, 1984.
That's a good one.
Both their mas are called Martha.
Is that true?
Fergie says they're both engaged to Christian Nadi. That is unfortunately incorrect. There was also another one that came in.
That's good. There's some
from
good ones
Ian
there.
Thompson. He says Fernando Torres has a brother called Israel, and Morris Malpass got his first Scotland cap against Israel. I can tell you, nobody's got it right. All incorrect answers. Scottish football's even greater. Hardest question continues. Get your answers in on At Big Football Scott. And also, you can leave your answers on YouTube as well. We'll get
in
to them
the,
next
in the
week.
Last 3 weeks, has anyone been close? That means I. That means that somebody's kind of...
I'm not going to say words, but I'll go...
Yeah, they're there or there's about. Yeah, there or there's about.
Is what I'll say. So Scottish football's even greater hardest question. Hopefully someday we'll get the answer. It's been going since the 26th of February now. So next week it'll be a month. So come on, up your game.
You're
what's the connection
close
between Morris Malpass and Fernando Torres? Right, let's move on to the quiz then, shall we?
Here we go.
Another defeat coming up for Ewen Cameron. As per usual, it's a penalty shootout quiz. We each take turns, and obviously we've got top bin questions. Ewan's getting the film questions because he's shite at the football ones, but not quite as shite as the film ones, obviously. And I'll get football questions. We'll flip the coin to decide who goes first. It's me to call it this week. I will go for tails. Never fails.
And it did.
And it did today. So
I'll go first.
Jesus Christ, you win the toss every single week. I guess you need to win at something because the score is 23-6.
It's not, it's 22-6.
It's 23-6, that's incorrect. And John, our producer, is also our quizmaster. Come on down, John.
Is it 23-6?
It's 23-6, yeah, it was 23-6.
It was half points, wasn't it?
It was half points, yeah. So, right, top bin, by the way, worth 2 points. You can take that at any point.
Yes.
And, here we go. Right, are you ready?
Right, Ewen, you're going first then?
Yeah, go on, bud.
Okay, right, you're sticking with the movies, yes?
Yeah,
Okay, no worries. Right, okay, your first question. Ewen Cameron, what is the name of the pirate in The Goonies?
Sloth, final answer.
Final answer?
Yeah.
And Marshall is saved! Yes!
I've never seen The Goonies, so I don't know.
One-Eyed Willy. I asked what is the name of the pirate in The Goonies, and it's One-Eyed Willy. Sloth was the one of the guys that went down to try and find the treasure from One-Eyed Willy's.
Whoa.
Hold on. What?
What?
He did say what's the name of the pirate in The Goonies. That was the question. And you said Sloth. And the answer was One-Eyed Willy, so you've got the question wrong. Sorry, Ewen.
No.
What?
What did,
Shut up.
Right, go on Google right now.
Shut
what
up.
What is the name of the pirate in Goonies? Let's just see what pops up, will we?
Sloth has got... Oh, he's got two eyes.
Yeah, the pirate in the Goonies was called One-Eyed Willy.
Have you Googled that?
It's One-Eyed Willy. Bad start for you.
I jumped in too quick.
Right, let's move on.
Right, Stephen, which former Heart striker currently plays with Coventry City?
Ellis Sims. Final answer.
Wait, what?
Why upset you?
We were talking about him on the big
I didn't hear the show on Saturday.
Do you want to turn this music bed down? Because it's doing my nutting already.
It's a wee bit loud.
It's the tension.
It's a wee bit loud.
Is that what's putting you off, you?
Yeah.
That's what.
I could hardly hear what you were saying.
Oh, right. Is that what it was?
Right. Key's question two.
Right. Who won the Oscar for Best Actor for his performance in There Will Be Blood?
Daniel Day-Lewis, final answer.
I think he's won a few, hasn't he?
He has won a few. He's retired now.
Has he retired?
Retired.
Right, Stephen. Mm-hmm. What nationality is Livingston striker Tetty Yenge?
Oh, Jesus. I've got no idea.
Good player, actually. He's done all right for them.
I think he'll stay in the Premiership. I agree with you. I think someone will take him.
100%.
I'll go French. Final answer.
And Marshall is saved! Yes!
1-1. He's Australian. There you go.
Get in.
Ewen.
Yes.
How many Jaws films has there been?
5, final answer.
And Marshall is saved! Yes!
There was meant to be a 5th Jaws come out, but they stopped the production on it. So there's only been 4 Jaws films.
You can't just... You need to take producer John's word for it.
Wait.
I googled this a couple of times. Because if you initially google, there will be 5 films that pop up, Ewen. But if you go into the Wikipedia, there's actually only 4 films that were made.
Wait.
Jaws 1, Jaws 2, Jaws the Revenge.
Oh, my, you're right. There was a script written and everything went into production. Yeah. They cancelled it.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Right.
Steven.
Yeah.
Shh.
How many teams are in the Highland League?
Jesus Christ. I've not looked at the Highland League table for a while, so I don't know.
No. Do you not even know who's top of the Highland League?
I don't think it's Brechin.
Ewen, how is that a clue?
Just don't even speak to him. Don't engage in conversation. Do you ever see anybody like Michael McIntyre on the wheel engaging and discussing the
That is all quiz show hosts do. They talk over the contestant. Right, so you're sure about that answer, and then give us your reasoning behind your answer, because that happens. It does my tits in. It's in Christian tits.
If it does your Christian tits in, well, then why are you doing it, you prick?
I'll go...
Practice what you preach.
I genuinely don't know, so I'll go... 14. Final answer.
And Marshall is saved!
12.
Yes!
18.
18?
Never got that.
Still 1-1.
Do you know what? You've been really nasty to me today, Ewen.
It's 1-1. Be nice
to John.
Right.
It's 1-1 on question 4.
I wish I'd changed this question, made them harder for you, Ewen, because this is easy. What is the name of the fictional African country in Black Panther? This is dead easy, Ewen.
I don't even like Marvel movies.
Well then, good.
I know it. I've seen it on a flight.
The last time I watched a Marvel movie, it was The Last Guardians of the Galaxy. And before that, it was probably... the previous Guardians of the Galaxy movie. I can't be arsed with it. It's all over the place. They took the piss with all those movies.
In terms of like liking child's films, it's just Star Wars that you like then, yeah?
Nothing wrong with Star Wars.
Star Wars isn't a kid's movie yet. It's so disrespectful.
It is disrespectful, you and I agree with you.
Oh, jeez.
Anytime you like, you.
How many words are in the name?
Oh, shut up.
Not telling you. Ewen, you've just said to me, like, don't talk to the contestants, so shut up.
I remember the big fight scene at the end of the... Is it the Age of Ult? Is it when they have that big, massive fight and everyone joins forces?
Ewen, if you've not seen it and you don't know,
Steven, just say anything.
Like, if you don't know, then just say you don't know and we can all move on.
Because
you're not... Like,
my kids watch it.
Like, you're not going to be able to guess this.
Yeah, I can if I think about it.
Well, that's not a guess then. That's just getting the answer correct.
Just give me a second.
Like, I guessed 14 because I didn't know. And I wanted to move on with my life.
Was it not, was it not the name of the film? Was it not, Wakanda Forever? Is that not the name of the film? Is a place called Wakanda Forever?
I'm not allowed to talk to the contestants, Ewen, so you'll not get
but
any
answers.
But
is it not something like Black Panther, the sequel? Was it not something like something Wakanda Forever or something? Is that the name of the place? Was there not 2 Black Panther movies and
Answer the question.
Wakanda.
Wakanda is your final answer.
Was that not the second film?
Is this your final answer?
Is it your final answer?
No.
Oh, Jesus.
So you're stuck between Wakanda and Wakanda forever.
Do you know?
Yeah.
But is that not the secret? If I say Wakanda forever, is that not the right answer? Do you want...
And the name of the country, I need the name of the fictional country.
Well, you're not
going to
call the country forever Wakanda.
Final answer.
Yeah.
Right, we got there in the end.
Is it a sequel to the film?
Yeah, Wakanda Forever was the sequel to
get
that.
Get in!
Yeah.
Fucking get in! 2-1, question 4, get
right,
in!
Right, Stephen, which club connects Jim Goodwin, Jack Ross and Barry Ferguson?
Aloha, final answer.
Oh, you!
Oh, straight in there.
Oh, no, it's in the final question!
Sudden death here, boys.
Oh, no!
Unless you want to go for the top.
No, I'm not gambling it this week.
Because
not a
what could happen here, Ewen, is that you could get it right and then Stephen could top Bennett.
I know, and went with it.
Right, but you know, we'll give you your question, right?
Come on then.
What 1992 movie starring Tom Hanks and Gina Davis shares its name with a quiz show? What 1992 movie starring Tom Hanks and Gina Davis shares its name with a quiz show?
Tom Hanks? Gina Davis?
Yep.
I love Gina Davis. She was in that pirate film that I love that her husband directed. Tom Hanks and Gina Davis were in a movie that's also the name of a quiz show.
Yep.
The Wheel. No. Blockbusters.
Play your cards right.
The Generation Game. Generation Game.
Catchphrase.
Hold on.
Blind date.
That's not a quiz show.
It's a quiz show.
I would say it's probably a quiz show, yeah.
Tom Hanks and Gina Davis were in a movie that's also the name of a quiz show.
Blankety blank.
I love Tom Hanks and I love Gina Davis.
Right, Ewen, come on. Please hurry up.
Steve, you need to stop rushing me.
I'm not rushing. I'm so not rushing you. But I just want you to hurry up.
Is it an American quiz show? Is it Jeopardy?
I've got no idea. I don't know.
That sounds like a movie, doesn't it?
Yeah, lots of things sound
but
like...
I don't remember Tom Hanks being in a movie called Jeopardy.
Oh, well, please just give an answer. Ready, steady, cook.
Was Ready, Steady, Cook a quiz show? That was more of a reality-based show, I would say.
I think it was more of a... It was a cooking show.
Is it The Chase? At the moment, I'm going with Jeopardy or The Chase.
I think
Deal or No Deal?
The Chase. Deal or No Deal's not a bad show, actually, for the name of a movie. Deal or No... Oh, John?
Mm-hmm.
Is it one of those three?
Oh, shut up!
I'm not allowed to talk to the contestants, Ewen.
Right, come on, Ewen. Just pick an answer. Come on.
I'm going to kick myself here. I just know I am. None of those three sound like it. That's a movie, Tom. Jeopardy, The Chase, Deal or No Deal. Name of a quiz show. The Wheel. Could it be The Wheel?
Right, come on! Pick an answer!
Jesus.
I'm going to go the Chase final answer.
Chase final answer.
Yeah. Oh, shit! Yes. I'm curious to know.
Pointless tipping point?
A League of Their Own.
It starred Madonna.
Madonna was in it as well.
It's with the baseball team.
Yeah, during the war. The
and the song in it is This Used to Be My playground, sung by Madonna. Why didn't you not mention Madonna instead of Gina
because
Davis?
Because I knew that would give it away to you. Because Gina Davis and Tom Hanks, there you go. So
great film.
This is for the win, Stephen Mill.
I know. I've watched the film about a million times as well. They go on a tour of America, ladies' baseball team.
I always get really disappointed when I'm flicking across the TV channels and see The League of Their Own going, oh, love that movie, I'll put it on, and then there's James Corden. I'm like, fuck. Right, okay, Stephen, your final question to win it.
Mm-hmm.
Who has the number 10 shirt at Celtic?
I actually genuinely don't know that. I'd hazard a guess at it, but...
It's not Kyogo. It's not Nicholas Kuhn. Do you not get
It's not Palma. Palma's 7.
I'm getting right
because I've heard that's been a question on Beat the Pundit or something. Number 10.
Please just get this wrong.
I've got no idea.
Can I just get a draw if we get this wrong? So it'll leave you happy.
I've honestly got no
idea.
I think
he's at it. I think he's playing me here.
It's not James Forrest.
I can see, look at his smile on your face.
I genuinely don't know.
You're messing with my head now. I bet you the money gets this right. I would actually put a fair bit of money on it, him getting this right, because he's just messing with my head here and just winding me up and I don't know what it is. I'm already packing up to go because he's just messing my head here.
This is a guess.
Shut up.
It genuinely is.
I guess. Is it? What a load of shite. Look at me. I can tell by you, look in your eyes, you know the answer. Stop it. Just give them the answer so I can leave.
I genuinely don't know.
Oh, shut up.
What is it, number 10?
Number 10.
Number 10. I'm genuinely struggling. Because I'm thinking, I'm between like two players.
John, you keep rushing me to hurry up with my answer. He's just winding me up here. The longer
I
he takes
to rush answer, it, it's Stephen that rushes
right,
you.
Right, well, he's taking the piss.
I'm not.
And I think when he takes the piss, and it's obvious that he's taking the piss, he should be docked points. A bit like Dundee and their pishy pitch, they should be fined and docked points. Look how long he's taking when he knows the answer just to wind me up, and it's pissing me off.
Give him
the answer so I can fucking leave.
I'm between two.
Right. Oh, amazing. I'm going to do it between two, and then you'll whittle it down to the one that's actually right, because you know who it is.
I genuinely don't know. Right. I genuinely
don't
know.
Just give him the answer. Give him a name. Give him a name.
But I'm just trying to think.
Give him a name.
Because I'll have seen this person, number 10, because it's one of the main numbers.
Give him a name.
I just need to think.
John, see from next week
when
John, he's ripping the piss the way that he is.
I think from next week we put a time limit on the questions because I'm fed up of you, Ewen, taking ages.
Look at this!
Stephen's taking ages now. He's
I genuinely don't know.
Well, just give me an answer.
It's not Joe Hart.
Oh, Jesus God. You're sounding
it's
like
not
Alan
Johnson. It's not Callum McGregor.
Even before he gives his answer, I'm going to leave because he knows the answer and he's just dragging us out to wind me up.
I don't think he does.
I'll go for final answer. No, wait, actually.
John, I think you, as Quizmaster, should be a bit more tough.
I don't. I'm genuinely struggling here.
I think you need to be tougher here, John. A bit like the SPFL when it comes to Dundee.
Right. I'm going to go. I've decided. Or is it him, actually? I don't know.
Oh, jeez, Stephen.
Okay. Final answer.
Uh-huh.
Matt O'Reilly.
Final answer.
And Marshall is saved!
I told you I didn't know! What is it? Who is
Nicholas
it?
Nicholas Coon.
Is it Nicholas
Coon? You said it!
The number you said it. It's not him. So confidently as well. Right.
I can't believe it.
Do you want to go for your top bin questions? Yeah.
Yeah.
And then, or do you like people getting annoyed because we're not, it should be decided?
No, I want top bin.
Let's go top bin.
You and your top bin question.
Yeah.
What was the first animated movie to be nominated for Best Picture at the Oscars?
It's Snow White or Cinderella. Or is it Bambi? It's one of those three. Snow White is the first one. And then Bambi is the second movie. And I think Cinderella is the third. It has to be Snow White because it would have been Earth. It would have been... Oh, it's one of those three. Does Snow White even get a nomination? What was your question again?
What was the first animated movie to be nominated for Best Picture at the Oscars?
Madagascar, is it?
Snow White.
Cars.
Snow White is... Was Snow White before Cinderella?
Wall-E.
Was Snow White before Cinderella? Or was it Bambi? Oh, God! I put it down in my head!
Just pick an answer.
Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, final answer. Is it Bambi?
Is it Fantasia?
No, it's Beauty and the Beast.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Are you sure about that?
Ewen, do you want to Google it? I mean, this is what obviously happens on Who Wants to Be. Hold on, Chris. I want to just check your answer there. I'll just Google that to see if you're talking the truth.
Right, give me my question.
You can go out. Right, Stephen, how many Premiership clubs have their established date on the badge?
Jesus Christ. I think Hibs do. I think Aberdeen do.
Oh, it was Beauty and the Beast.
I told you it was Beauty and the Beast.
1991.
There you go. Oh, we learnt something today.
Why could the first question not be what was our first ever animated movie? Was it? Would it have been Snow White then? Stephen.
Yeah.
Mate. Hearts got beat, right?
Yeah.
At the weekend.
Yeah. Oh, Hearts, that's a good answer, actually, yeah. Forgot about them.
It'd be nice if we just drew the day. We shook hands and we left the building at the same time.
I'm inclined to agree with that, so I'm going to guess five. Final answer, off you go.
You're guessing five, yep. Final answer.
Final answer.
Are we skipping out the room together, happy, holding hands?
I'm afraid not.
Amazing times.
I'll give you the teams: Motherwell, Aberdeen, Hibs, Celtic and Hearts. All
amazing times. Great times
here.
Brilliant times. 24-2. And I have won again.
24-6, you prick.
24-1. I mean, it's just an absolute thumping so far this season. So thank you to everyone who supported me through that. Sorry I took so long. And John, I'm more than happy to put a time limit on the questions from next week. I think that's totally fine. Fine by me.
Right.
Fine by Ewan. Ewan's greeting across there with his Costa and his bits with orange in it and all the rest of it. Anyway, I'd like to dedicate this win to Christian Titz because he's quite frankly been an inspiration this week. It's been
funny.
Christian Titz everywhere.
That joke was done half an hour ago, mate.
It was more than that. We're running late today, so Ewan's falling over and nearly breaking the studio.
Yeah, well, you see when you stand on a wheel, that's what happened.
Oh, that was really funny. Right, it's the end of the podcast. Thank you very much for listening and for watching this week. I think Ewan is actually, he's broken the studio. And we have broken him because he lost the quiz again. So get in touch for Scottish football, what you're putting in the bin. Obviously, we'll reopen that next week. We'll shove something in the bin. Get your nominations in on Epic Football Score. Always leave your comments, feedback, good or bad, on YouTube as well. We like to see that. And of course, get involved for Scottish football's greater, even hardest question. Hopefully, someday I'll get an answer this time next week. It is, what's the connection between Maurice Malpass and Fernando Torres? It's international break this week, so we'll be back with some Scotland chat next week, and enjoy your week, everyone. Ta-ta, bye-bye.